And welcome to ETF Edge, your go-to place for everything exchange-traded related. I'm your host, Bob Pisani, joined today by Tom Lydon of ETFTrends.com, Dan Wiener of Advisor Investments. Let's start today with the markets because the S&P 500 is 1% off its historic high, but you wouldn't know it from the trading action. Last week saw the lightest trading volumes of the year at the New York Stock Exchange. So what's going on? Even with the markets rising, there's plenty of nervousness. This is an unloved rally. We've said that many times over the last several years, but that might just be the best thing the market has going for it. Dan Wiener, the low volume and low volatility, a bullish sign? Is this a contrarian indicator? How are we supposed to read this?
You know, it's hard to figure out, but the market actually hit an all-time high on Friday. You know, I always like to say dividends matter.
You include the dividends.
Yeah, yes. Of course. Well, I mean, are you giving away your dividends? Right. I don't think so. So the S&P total return hit an all-time high on Friday. So low volume, hard to understand. I think a lot of people don't understand what's going on in this market.
Well, Tom, isn't the obvious explanation that the unloved rally story that you and I have been talking about for the last 4 or 5 years, we're hitting new highs? Under traditional technical analysis, you'd want some confirmation that more people are buying into the rally as we're near the new highs. This kind of tells us that a lot of people are still skeptical. Isn't that the right way to look at it?
I think you're absolutely right. But when you look back at the fourth quarter, ETF investors surprisingly weren't selling. They were actually buying when mutual fund investors were selling. Then when you look into this quarter, there wasn't as much buying as we saw in Q1 of 2018. I think people are fully in. They're fully invested, and there's just not that much more to buy at this point in time.
Well, so it's different than what I was saying. I'm saying some people are still staying out by definition. They're still waiting to get in to see if the rally is real. Maybe if we hit new highs, I'm kind of going against your idea here, that'll drag in more people and add fuel to the rally.
I think you have a bifurcation of behavior among investors today. ETF investors seem to be on the more on the buy and hold side. Yeah. Fund investors, as we know, very emotional, buying and selling, maybe at the wrong time.
Dan, you've got $5 billion in assets under management. You're also one of the great experts on Vanguard. You write a newsletter on Vanguard investing. Vanguard's been very successful moving into the ETF business. Vanguard has some funds that are mutual funds and very similar funds that are essentially ETFs.
Right.
How do you distinguish between them when you're making recommendations to your clients?
Well, basically, first of all, we're big believers in active management. You know, Jack Bogle used to say, if you can earn 1% more, you're doing just great. Well, at Vanguard, you can do that with some of their active managers. Some of the active managers that we found outperform the indexes. So our first choice is look for a great active manager and buy that first. Then if we have to go down and look at the ETFs versus the indexes, we're looking at how big they are, whether there's a lot of active trading going on inside of them. We're trying to figure out what's in those indexes. Because, you know, we were talking about healthcare earlier today. The difference between these various indexes, what's in them, how much they're weighted, it makes a big difference to the investor.
Do you have an overweight recommendation in any sector?
We have been overweight healthcare since the day we opened our doors almost 25 years ago. But through active. You know, our manager that we've used, either Fidelity's active healthcare fund or Vanguard's active healthcare fund, or the Hartford fund, which also uses the same manager as Vanguard's from Wellington. They don't own either Johnson & Johnson or Pfizer, which are the two biggest holdings in the ETFs.
Well, Vanguard Healthcare, one of the legendary healthcare funds, used to be run by Ed Owens, legendary investors. Right. And it's a tricky game moving between medical devices, biopharmaceutical, or just gigantic pharmaceutical companies. Yeah. You kind of have to have a sense of market timing in a way.
Well, you point out Vanguard, most people in the ETF world look at them as the big indexers, but they've got a great active business. Dan, what do you think about these businesses combining now that we're going to have active management within Vanguard ETFs?
You know, the question really is what kind of disclosure there is. Listen, the ETF business, the 20 ETFs represent how much of the, you know better than I, it represents what, 90% of the assets? Everything else is ETFs on the margin. People playing around with different ideas. Throw it up against the wall, see if it sticks. You know, the factor business that Vanguard's gotten into, the ESG business that Vanguard's gotten into, it's become a marketing game now. You know, Vanguard under Jack Bogle, you never referred to a mutual fund or an ETF as a product. Today, it's all product.
Let's move on here. I want to just get our gentleman's thoughts on a couple of key stories here in the last week. Let's look across the industry groups and I'll dig a little deeper because I want to show you something. Even as we're approaching new highs, investors are betting heavily against the leaders. So what does this mean? So look here. Retail and semiconductor stocks have seen double-digit gains this year. They're the market leaders, but they are the most shorted ETFs out there. Check out this XRT. We talk about this all the time. It's a weighting of the bigger retail stocks that are out there. More than 500% of its assets are sold short. What's that all about? Semis have more than 100% sold short. Oil and gas stocks, they're not far behind. Tom, other than telling me what you think about this, can you just explain to everyone, how do you actually short 500% of an ETF? Right. How do you physically do that?
So we were talking about this earlier. It's in a whole variety of different ways. There's obviously securities lending that is one component, but a lot of these bigger ETFs actually have options that you can buy against those as well, and you can buy them in a big right. way. And the other thing is the accounting of that, and we beforehand when we got on here were questioning those numbers because that's kind of off the charts. How could a long position actually be 500?
But could you actually short a stock more than once in multiple lending? Is that that might be possible as
from well? From Wall right. Street accounting standards, I guess the answer is yes.
Yeah.
But what it does say, back to your point, is big box retailers are getting unloved in a yeah. big way, and we're going to continue to see more of this, especially as this market gets higher. The question is, can these companies continue to bring profitability?
Well, Dan, that's the obvious answer here with the XRT. They're betting that the big box guys, this little reprise that they had in the middle of last year on the Amazon wars, is not going to last.
But I mean,
would you
this,
agree that's the
sure,
story
sure.
here?
Sure, sure. But doesn't this speak to what we were talking about just a little earlier, which is that this market has either reached new highs or, as you say, almost has reached new highs, and yet there's very low volume, right? People seem to be a little bit more bearish. They're certainly not running with the bulls, you know, and buying with abandon. You have a big short position, it means somebody's hedging.
Yeah.
Or a lot of somebody's are hedging.
Fortunately, earnings are good so far. We just don't need any interruptions, right?
Well, and also there's very high expectations around a China deal,
yeah.
right?
Yeah, and when you get these kinds of moves up, it makes sense. I mean, that's a tough story to argue, long-term growth in big box retailing. So this makes a little bit of sense to me. Let's move on to a growing trend that's all the rage in the ETF business, and that's factor investing. This is simply building portfolios using indexes based on something other than market capitalization. But do they actually outperform? Goldman Sachs seems to think so. Their suite of active beta ETF takes four different factors: value, quality, momentum, and low volatility, and then combines them in various ways into a very low-cost ETF, only 9 basis points. That's SPDR, SPY's level right now. Their largest fund, the Active Beta Large Cap, it's got Microsoft in it, Apple, Amazon, Facebook, as the largest components, but it's got a relatively low weighting. The top 10, for example, holdings here only make up 17%. Steve Sachs joins us now. He's head of capital markets for ETFs at Goldman Sachs Asset Management. Congratulations. Good to see you again.
Bob, it's always good to see you.
It's, I think, interesting that Goldman decided to approach the whole ETF business in a slightly different way. Rather than let's create a suite of plain vanilla ETFs and utilize our existing investment base and bring them in, they brought you in, they created a series of factor ETFs and got a really low price on that. 9 basis points is pretty low, and you've been successful. You've got some significant assets under management.
We do. In fact, we just hit $12 billion in assets this week across our ETF suite, which is now a total of 18 products. As you mentioned, our flagship suite is really the active beta suite. It consists of 6 strategies, GSLC being our flagship fund. That fund alone is approaching $5 billion in assets. So to your point, what we really saw at Goldman was not getting into the ETF space because that's the thing to do these days. We actually had these strategies existing inside Goldman for a number of years. In fact, the active beta strategies have a significant amount of institutional assets benchmarked to them in separate account form. Our institutional clients and our advisor clients were coming to us and asking us, can you deliver these strategies in an ETF wrapper? Going back to the conversation that you gentlemen were having earlier, that's all an ETF is, right? It's just a delivery mechanism. No. It's not a separate business. It's delivering investment strategies through the ETF wrapper.
I guess the problem I have is I completely agree with everyone who says God did not say thou shalt invest only in market cap weighted, you know, investments or indexes. And yet, intellectually, market cap weighted makes the most sense. It certainly makes more sense than price weighted indexes that we all know and love. And yet, Is there enough of an investment history to show that factor weighted, and specifically the ones that you're talking about here, value, quality, momentum, low volatility, actually outperforms at all?
Yeah, we think so. Certainly when you look at GSLC, since inception, and certainly if you look at the last year, GSLC actually outperformed 80% of all of the mutual funds and ETFs out there in the large blend category. And the idea behind active beta, which is just our brand name for smart beta, to your point, it's four factors. It's equally weighting those factors in a portfolio. And the idea is this, right? At the end of the day, the hardest part of the puzzle is the asset allocation. Security selection becomes a very challenging exercise, particularly in US large cap, right? When you think about what active managers are exposed to, though, at the security level, they're exposed to value and quality and momentum and low volatility.
It's certainly been around a long time, Dan Wiener. You've got $5 billion in assets under management. What do you tell clients when they ask you about factoring and active
beta?
Well,
first of all, Vanguard got into this business a year ago, right? And to be able to determine which factor you want to emphasize, and you know, they're in the same business, the value and the quality and the momentum and the minimum volatility. And if you look at the performance, month to month, quarter to quarter, it's all over the map. Of the five or six different factor ETFs that Vanguard's come up with, the two with the most money have been the two worst performers since inception. Yeah. I mean, you really can't. And factors is, you know, I hate to be the cynic on the show here, but factors is just another the fancy way of saying we're gonna slice the bologna a little different.
He's right. It's been around a long time. I mean, value investing, how old is that? And that's a factor here that's waiting. So what I notice is, depending on how you slice and dice it, if you just use one of them, you can get an outperformance at certain times. And if you combine them all, you can get a certain outperformance. But do you get any long-term? In other words, is there a compelling case to go to the average investor and say, yes, you should consider this?
Well, I think there is, and you mentioned long-term. There is factor chasing that goes on, and we can tell just by the flows. People buy the wrong factors at the wrong times. However, if you look back when early factor investing in the ETF space was really getting hot, it was pre-financial crisis. And through 07 to 09, factor strategies did quite well compared to capital market weighting. So we really are in a situation where those that are looking at factors are doing it because they want a defensive strategy. They feel the market might be a little bit long in the tooth. And if we see a major correction going forward.
And how do you sell this, Steve? Yeah, how do you go out and tell people, like, you need this as X part of your portfolio? Yeah. What kind of investor? How is this? Who's buying?
So you guys are actually making our point for us from the active beta perspective, right? When you think about GSLC, GEM, which is our emerging markets fund, all the same strategy. It's the reason we use four factors, and it's the reason we combine them in the way that they do, right? We would actually argue with you guys. We think single factor investing is very, very difficult. Very hard to time factors, very hard to pick which one is going to be in favor this year. When you combine four factors like the ones that we do, they actually have a very low, or even in most cases, very negatively correlated relationship to each other, which again, the idea is to give a better risk-adjusted return. It's also all about tracking error. And what do I mean by that? It's the amount of risk you're taking versus the S&P 500 or the cap-weighted benchmark. Yeah. The idea with multi-factor investing should really be to take a small amount of tracking error to give yourself a much better risk-adjusted return, not making outsized bets, particularly in things like low vol, which can actually go against you, strangely.
We gotta go, but my point here is, you've actually, GSLM has performed pretty close to the S&P 500. Was that intentional?
It is. GSLC and the entire active beta suite, by design, targets a relatively low tracking error, about 2% from its original calibration at design. And that's on purpose. The idea is to let these factors work smoothly together in a better risk adjusted
10 seconds.
Fashion.
I was just going to say, people have been using factors for decades. Small cap value, mid cap growth.
Yeah.
They're all factors.
Absolutely.
Thanks, guys. This does it for this week's ETF Edge. I'm Bob Pisani. My thanks to Steve, Dan, and Tom, all friends, for joining us today. And thank you for watching. You can find all of our latest videos right here on our website, etfedge.cnbc.com. We'll see you next Monday, same time, same place. Have a good week.